Prepare yourself for a sprawling discussion on just about anything, where critical thinking meets pop culture in a collision of mind-bending proportions. Please secure all neurons and prepare for full frontal cortex. It's time for Incoherent Ramblings.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to a new episode of Incoherent Ramblings. This is episode 029. Future energy! Energy of the future!
Just got blue immediately.
What? What happened?
Scared the crap out of me.
Oh, good. So, what we're going to do today is...
We're going to talk
about the future of energy. This was Kale's topic from last week. I'm your host, Joey Shamble. We also got...
Paul Hottinger.
Kale Anderson.
And I'm always last, Daryl Jordan.
Daryl always comes last.
Why is that?
Endurance.
Oh, man. So, you can email us at darylcomeslast@...
Wait. When did you register that?
I'm
going to
set that up right now.
You can email us, I am rambling at...
Show@iamrambling.com.
Show. All right, so today we're going to be talking about future energy. Stop rubbing me. And before we get to future energy, though, we are going to do our pre-ramble. So our pre-ramble today is all about photons and what they've become. Those damn photons. No, Kale found an article.
Large photon torpedoes!
Have you seen that Star Trek thing where the Star Trek coming out of the Star Destroyer? And they're like, they don't even have shields. They're shooting lasers at us. Yeah. Go ahead and beam a photon torpedo onto their main deck. Make it so. Anyway, so...
Damn the photon torpedoes.
Damn them.
No, Spock's in that one, no!
So photons apparently are, as you may know, light, and they don't interact with each other. If you shine two lasers at each other, they'll go through each other.
That's the common thinking.
However, Kale has found an article where they have finally found a way to make photons interact with each other, which can make a lot of possible science fiction fantasies real.
This will make Comic-Con very dangerous.
So, Kale, I'm
very dangerous. Comic-Con.
Well, go ahead, Kale. Tell us a little bit about it.
Well, from what it says is that they've been able to take photons and create molecule-like arrangements, which makes us think that there is mass to photons and that it gives them interesting possibilities, such as maybe a lightsaber or maybe a shield.
It makes something that has mass that moves at the speed of light.
Well, actually, they slow it down, so at that point, it's not. But that's the whole idea, is they're taking it, they put it through a medium, which slows it down, and it kind of becomes part of the medium. But I think what surprised them the most...
Like a psychic?
I was going to say, like, what's her name? The
Sylvia Brown?
Yes. Put it through her. Let's see how she likes it.
What, Miss Cleo?
Yeah, that too. Okay.
Oh my goodness.
Boy, you just dated yourself there.
Yeah, no kidding.
When you call the tech guy or the medium, you call 1-800 Ask Cleo.
Don't ask me, son. So, anyway.
You can reach her in jail.
They also
found
that.
88-88.
They also found that.
Ask Cleo.
Go ahead, try again.
They also.
Now you know what it's like. Remember last episode?
Okay, it's not me.
Oh.
It was them mostly. Okay, it was me a little bit.
We never do that.
No. Damn.
So when it goes
through. So it's going through something.
No, seriously, I'm over it now. I'll stop interrupting.
As the photon exits, if they send two photons into this medium and they both exit, they become one photon, which is kind
of
weird.
It's kind of entanglement, which is a known.
But they're also saying
one, like the Spice Girls.
The article is not so much about making lightsabers. They just say it's possible. It's more about using them for quantum computers because they're saying they can put information onto them as they're more molecule-like. So it might be the first step.
Now, how slow are they going? Because we're talking about I didn't read the article, so they're talking about a molecule-like structure. Does it mean they're sitting still there?
They give them the example as when light enters water, it kind of takes on the attributes of the water as it goes through it, but when it exits out of the water, it's still light again.
Oh, it's light homeopathy.
Wow! I thought you were a homeopathy folk. I'm impressed.
So it's BS. But
Daryl's a homeo.
So it's homeopathic.
Yeah, that's
right. So
homeo, don't play that.
So look who's dating themselves now. Yeah. So apparently, that has something to do with it. I didn't really understand too much about it, but you can look up the article.
Well, maybe if they actually put it into a Bose-Einstein condensate, that it actually would look like an actual
like a speaker, Bose speakers.
Yeah, I've got a subwoofer that's like that.
but Kale, like, does it mention though? How do you get the different colors? Like green, red, blue? Because I like to have my lightsaber where I could change the hilt.
Dude, it's the crystals.
And change the colors.
It's the crystals.
Yeah. I mean, for this. For the plasma, I don't like crystals.
No,
we all know about the crystals.
They're just saying it's possible. It's not... It's not. They're not actually looking to make lightsabers. They're just saying that this gives the theoretical possibility that since it shows that energy could be take on the properties of certain matter that they would be able to possibly make something like a lightsaber or a shield or something. They're actually more interested in the idea of quantum computing with this.
Of course they are, but they're not admitting that the rest of us want lightsabers.
Let me run something by you guys as maybe an illustration of this, because I did not read the article, but I'm wondering if it's something like a standing wave in a river where the wave itself is sitting there, but the water molecules are rushing through.
Now
so is it like that where the photons are rushing through the structure?
Well, that's not what they said, but I think that's a good analogy that maybe that's how it could be matter and wave.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. I like that.
But I'm just wondering if they have to keep an emitter.
Patented by Daryl George.
Do they have to keep a laser pointed at it to maintain it, or can they turn the laser off and it's still there as a molecule?
Self-sufficient.
That's the part I'm kind of wondering about. Like, my thing may not be applicable at all. So.
No, I don't think they really go into that.
Anyway, this was kind of thrown at me last minute, so I did not read it. But next time I will. So the home audience doesn't have to hear me conjecture forever.
Well, no, it's okay. Because the
conjecture is
the idea behind the pre-ramble is kind of, you guys haven't really heard it, and we bring it up.
Okay, and then this is kind
and
of you
can explain and get your uninformed opinion.
We're the vacuous audience.
Like real news.
Yeah, like Fox News.
Fox you! Hashtag shut the fox up.
Hashtag shut the front door.
All right. So that's enough of the
pre-ramble.
You know what I want to do one time is get together with three of you and say when we do pre-ramble, but be quiet except for one of you and just see what they do.
We'll probably...
And it'll be one person go...
When we'll you said get together with the three of us, I thought you were going something.
Yeah, what happens? We'd be looking at all the others sheepishly going, bah, 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 bah.
Just use more lube.
Daryl wanted to come last again.
I know.
Okay, so...
I'm not comfortable with that in this company, all right? That is just so wrong.
I'm not comfortable with that in any company, especially Daryl's. All right, so let's talk about... We're going to start big with nuclear fission, because that is a...
Remind us what our actual subject is again.
I've totally
forgotten.
And who it's brought
it
to
us. It was.
And where we can be emailed.
Scroll down a little bit.
Scroll down.
I did the email. The future of energy. And brought to you today by Energon Cubes. No, wait, that's not what we decided. What we're going to do. Oh, look, right here, I got a figure. It's.
Oh, my God.
It's.
Captain Planet!
Captain Planet, now, the future of energy.
Wind.
Fire.
Wood. Water. Earth. Speaking and hot.
Oh no, look! Our enemy, he's got wood! We can't form Captain Planet if he's got wood! Alright, so... Anyway...
His spandex will stick out too much.
Why do you look like Colossus?
He kind of does.
Yeah.
All right, so let's talk about nuclear fission. Nuclear fission has been around for a while, and there's been a lot of proponents, and there's been a lot of... what's the opposite of proponent?
Are you saying fission?
I don't even know what that
fusion.
Means.
Fission. Oh, crap.
Nuclear fission.
Fission, yeah.
Fission first.
That's
fission
the one first. That we're actually doing.
Fission exists. Like fusion does not exist yet.
No, it does.
No, that, it does.
But not
just not efficient.
Efficiently. No. But we're not there yet. So.
No.
Right.
So nuclear...
But fission is like... what's down south?
Fission is breaking things apart.
Right, basically.
Is that Onofre?
Breaking the atom apart and the energy.
Not
that,
with balls, those are down south.
With chips. So you have fission chips.
And the energy.
Age salt.
Age salt, dude.
The
salt.
Energy, which comes from the atom as it's split, It's a pretty reliable energy source. The problem is, of course, it does have nuclear waste.
A lot of waste, a lot of radioactive waste.
Yeah, radioactive waste associated with this, with it. But
especially when they're using breeder reactors, which create more plutonium.
Fusion, which we're not at yet.
Pinch it off! Don't make a shard.
Fission.
Let's finish.
Blows up the stars.
Okay. Actually, I think it's iron.
No,
that was. I want to edit that out now. That was okay. A big gap.
So, no, I think you should put an echo on it. Yes, Daryl. Yes. Okay. No, so there was something I once heard, and I'm sorry I'm even bringing this up. Maybe someone will find it out there. It was such an awesome argument for nuclear fission. It seemed in my head when I heard it on a show or whatever it was that you could not. This was a foolproof argument for it, and I don't remember what it was, but it was like I heard that and I was like, we should be using nuclear fission all the time. It's perfect. There's no problem with it.
Well, I mean, you get a lot of power out of it when a very little amount makes it, unless you're Homer and destroy the whole
thing. Yeah. Well, it's
carbon neutral for one thing. Yeah. And then we have issues of, you know, breathable air. So, you know, almost all of their power production other than wind and solar produces a certain amount of airborne contaminants, and those are going to give people diseases or bad time breathing.
This is relatively clean. Yeah, I mean, forgetting the radioactive.
Yeah, it's the radioactive waste, and then the fear of an accident. Yeah, I mean, because if there's an accident, it's horrendous.
What happened in Japan was a little bit of a warning to people who were really gung ho about nuclear power. I mean, I kind of was too, but then you see how, you know, forces of nature are impossible to contain.
Yeah.
And even though a facility can be run properly, you can wind up with a natural disaster causing a potential meltdown.
Right, and then it doubles or triples the problems from the natural disaster.
Exactly.
So, yeah. So, but that's nuclear fission, and that does exist, and it's probably going to exist into the future, but let's talk about nuclear fusion. And I'm not sure about this. If nuclear fusion were to exist, would it be far, and we were to make it efficient, would it be far more productive, so we wouldn't have to use nuclear fission, or would it clean up nuclear fission?
Well, the thing is that it would replace.
Okay, fission. That's what I was thinking. Yeah,
totally, because it would provide the energy in the same kind of manner in fusing instead of fizzing or separating. So it would be much clean. Well, it would be almost completely clean. And,
well, we should probably bring up that it has happened, and what nuclear fusion is taking basically the parts of atoms and putting them together. It's the opposite of fission. It's fusing atoms, which is what powers
the stars.
Yes, thank
you.
It
has to be heated up to like 100 million.
I hope you had a better
echo
on that.
Yeah. It has to be heated up to like 100 million degrees Celsius, something like that.
So we put more energy in than we get out from
the reaction. Kind of reactors that are most used now for fusion are tokamaks, which I posted a couple of YouTube videos.
Isn't
showing
Native American?
What?
Sounds
Isn't
Japanese.
That a Native American word?
Tokamak?
Tokamak.
Sure, sounds like it.
Big energy
tomahawk.
Of mass.
Oh, yeah?
That was racially insensitive, bro. Is that fair?
As if racially insensitive.
I mean, that...
Yes.
I can picture the Indian already with the tear dropping from his eye.
Native American.
Yeah,
so you're even incorrect.
Sense.
The only Indians here are in Cleveland.
Darn it.
So,
no matter what you say, you're going to be, you know.
Are they
somebody,
still working right? towards? I mean, is it something that
making
is going
it,
to happen?
Making it actually work, where we can actually get more power out than we put in. Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
They
so
are
that's
still working.
Is
on
it just a matter of time, or is it something that just may not happen unless we have something like the sun to power?
I think it's a matter of time.
I think it may not happen.
Oh.
You know, I am not.
Daryl versus Daryl versus Kale. Fight!
Ah!
No, I meant argue.
Oh, damn.
So why do you think it's going to happen?
I think it's going to happen because they keep incrementally improving their techniques. And the three different types that they're making, which is the...
Nina, the Pinta, and Santa Maria, yeah.
Right. Anyway, the ITER is the newest one that they are proposing and that they're going to build soon. And if it works the way they're thinking, they're going to get positive energy out.
Daryl, counterpoint.
All right, the counterpoint is that it's not theoretically proven that it actually can be done more efficiently than the energy you get out. So in a system like a star, you have the mass creating the friction and heat as it collapses upon itself, and that's what drives the fusion. And that energy that's coming out of the fusion may actually be less than what's...
counterpoint!
Gravity.
I agree with him on that, except... that I think the magnetic fields that we're using to contain the plasma is going to actually make that so that we don't need that extra collapsing energy.
Daryl, counterpoint.
Okay, you're right.
All right!
Oh, success!
Oh, yes!
Two wins.
All right, moving on.
And that's how we get the...
So that means I get to come last
in
now.
Star Trek.
All right, so let's move on from nuclear fusion and fission to battery power, because we've brought this up on previous episodes where Daryl is saying how it sucks.
Wait, what sucks?
Battery power. Basically, the technology... Not that...
Well, it's
not, not the proposed...
The evolution.
What we've got now.
Batteries now, yeah. they're behind the evolution of our technology.
Okay, I'll give you that.
Yeah, he's so agreeable.
So the batteries are still, catching up.
Yeah, so...
That's what's slowing us down.
Here's the thing about battery technology. It is this kind of like black art where you have to try different substances out, see how they
look
at
one another.
No, not quite like that.
Oh.
That was just wrong.
You ever heard of the Emancipation Proclamation? I don't listen to hip-hop.
Wow.
So did you see the...
South Park.
Did you see any of the posts about the microbial or the carbon nanotube batteries that are actually being experimented
with? I'm
familiar
with the carbon nanotube idea, not the microbial one.
The microbial one is really interesting, and of course...
Let me just get to the point, though, that the thing is, when you decide to try a new type of battery, it has to meet so many criteria that are all different, and oftentimes you'll find, components of a battery that when you put them together they excel in certain areas but they completely fail in others. And the thing is, for a battery to function in the real world, it has to meet all these dozens of criteria, like operating temperatures, how fast it can charge, how fast it can discharge, how much heat it generates while charging or discharging.
I can discharge
how
in about 30 seconds.
Yeah.
Right. If I really try.
Recharge about 20 minutes.
Is it stable?
Daryl comes last, Kale
light?
Comes first.
Is it light compared to its energy density? All these different things. And any one factor can really make it a bad battery if it misses one of these. Like, it might excel in everything. However, it weighs a ton per milliamp hour you can store in it, right? That would make it a big fail, because who wants to carry that around?
And what about disposal? Is that going to become a problem? Because honestly, lease it with regular cell batteries like AA's and things of that nature, I just throw them away. And some people I talk to go, what? You throw your batteries away? You're destroying the earth!
Why don't you leave your address so the EPA can come to your house?
Yeah. They can collect my batteries.
But that's the whole thing, is I think most people don't do anything to throw the batteries in the trash. No. That's how it's always been. But I've heard a lot of people saying that's bad.
At least in our area, there are
the
recycling centers.
Yeah, well, and also places
but it's not so much that. It's more... What about the fact that nobody does it? Or not nobody, but most people don't.
I think it's because it's convenience.
Exactly.
It's inconvenient to
but
do
is that.
But
is that an issue? Is that going to become a problem in the future if we... I mean, battery technology, Daryl's saying, we're still behind on it, but we use batteries for everything. And even though I'm talking about AA's, I mean, I think it's one of those things where we might just throw our batteries from our phones away or something like that if we're not thinking about it. But I guess e-waste is becoming more...
It's getting a little more convenient because, like, if you look at places like Target and Best Buy, they have more like e-waste recycling centers in their entrance and exit.
And they have like
your batteries, your.
Right. Plus, I have to go there.
California's charging recycling fees on computers that are sold. Also, I don't think they do it on phones at this point.
Well, and I saved up a whole bag of batteries because I was trying to be good, and then I took it to the recycling center. They wanted to charge me to recycle those batteries. Right, it was like, that. I mean,
wow. Hey!
19 minutes in.
Right. 19 minutes in, and we, oh, damn it.
Dude. But, some of the garbage companies.
Okay,
like
now we all have to get one in. Paul, you already got yours.
I already got mine.
Well,
Okay.
All right. So I actually think that in the future that there, like we have recycled now and the green waste, we're just going to have an e-waste thing that you put out, you know, and
that'd be kind of, you know, but the thing is, it's such low level for a typical household.
Now, that's why I'm talking.
In the future, everything's disposable, like, oh, I'm sick of this TV.
Right, exactly.
Let's get next week's TV in here.
Yeah.
But there's like companies, like, I know, like Athens Waste that picks up our trash and stuff. They take our garbage. You don't have the recycling. You put it all together.
They take our waste to the Acropolis.
They separate everything at their plant. So they could be taking out the batteries as well.
That's a good point.
But they do take out the metals and the plastics and all that, everything, stuff that they can be recycled, separate.
They take out the smell, too.
How nice. Because countries actually kind of specialize taking everybody's waste and then separating everything out.
LAUSD sells its, because it's got a lot of electronic waste, sells it to China, and they make money.
How much for an iPad?
Nothing off of it.
All right.
So, check Gazelle. So batteries, What fuel cells?
Another free plug.
Well, batteries, fuel cells. Where do they connect? How are they different?
I wanted to say about the wired microbes. That's what's making them feasible as batteries. The microbes is because they're taking carbon nanotubes and using them as wires that they attach to the microbes, and so the microbes provide the power and it goes.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
I wonder if you could get miniature potatoes and make
nanotube
potato batteries. That sounds interesting.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah, actually, something like, I don't think battery producers have explored a lot of organic materials for, I mean, they define an organic material, but I mean like living organisms or proteins, you know, things like that.
Do you think it's just the cost of developing that? I mean, so it's stopping
nanotubes have been pretty expensive. Another idea is to make existing lithium-ion batteries, at least I think it's lithium-ion, using graphene in them instead of how the elements are typically separated, because there has to be a permeable layer between the cathode and the anode on the battery, and that has to pass electrons either charging or discharging. So the idea was to get graphene, which is just a single atom of graphite, or carbon, actually, throughout there. So you can have this very permeable layer, which is tough enough to actually keep the two layers separated, the lithium and the... what is the other thing that's in the lithium? I guess it's lithium and ionized lithium, wouldn't it be?
Lithium ions.
Yeah. Right. So... So yeah, it can keep those two layers separated by just a sheet that's one atom thick. Again, though, it's an expense thing. Producing graphene is not easy.
Bullshit!
Okay.
Sorry, it's just getting boring. I wanted to put it on. Right.
So there's something in between.
Just showed up.
Sorry, it's my Tourette's. I didn't mean it.
Maybe that was Penn, not Teller. Teller normally doesn't say anything.
So there's something in between, kind of like a fuel cell.
Yeah.
Yeah, how about that?
Hey!
Nicely done.
Fuel cell batteries.
Could somebody please compare fuel cells to batteries for me? Alright.
Fuel cells can function as batteries.
But are they batteries?
Well, I understand a fuel cell. You have... Tritanium? No? Tritium?
Tritium?
Is that what it is? Or is that something else?
Dilithium?
Dilithium crystals? I don't know.
No, fuel cells operate off of combining oxygen and hydrogen together, and so it's like a batteries usually rely on something being ionized to pass the electrons from one material to another.
Oh no, it was something.
But when it comes to a fuel cell, the power is produced by combining oxygen and hydrogen atoms, and the real expensive, like, charging a fuel cell means putting in pure hydrogen.
Okay, got it.
Into it.
Got it.
And the byproduct off that is the electricity.
Right.
Got it. And the oxygen comes from the air. Okay.
So it doesn't rely on an ion transfer.
And the big setback on
I thought it was an article
on fuel cells is one of the big setbacks is that just creating the infrastructure to support it.
Because, yeah, it seems almost like the perfect energy. I mean, no byproducts that are really dangerous. I mean, well, the energy is.
And even on at the
water, right?
Like the fuel stations,
vapor.
All you'd have to do is actually put solar panels on the roof to create the electrolysis to separate, you know, the hydrogen.
But that is
off.
The point, though, is what powers that transfer. I mean, it's going to be hopefully partially clean energy, but then you're going to
Because of course you could still use the coal,
nuclear and coal and gasoline burning.
Yeah, the fossil fuels to create the hydrogen, but there's better ways.
Well, let's take a little break from the fuels here and let's put out our opinion on I'll call it what it is now, climate change. Because I think that this directly impacts it, and it's, in my opinion, I don't like it when something scientific gets political, because it gets very clouded. But and I think that a lot of people don't look at the facts; they just lean one way or the other. So I'm interested to see what each of you think towards what was once called global warming, and is now called climate change. Anyone want to jump in with that?
I think that global warming is the term that people use when they tend to say that it's man-made, and climate change is thought of more of what nature does.
Well, climate change, I think, has become more political because it was global warming, but then there was times where the temperature did go down, where global warming was just the temperature of the Earth that changed, but climate change is also... We've changed things to where now we get more tornadoes, or we get more...
Pablo's barking up the right tree.
Or more hurricanes.
See, this is where it starts to get...
It's not just one thing. Okay. Climate change as a whole.
Go ahead, okay, the thing is, okay, politically, this is a really messed up issue because the science is all on one side of it, that it's man-made and it's happening. So if you want to believe in science and scientific method, it's being proven over and over again that it's what's happening.
That we, as human beings, are affecting our climate.
But between those two, climate change is the more up-to-date, accurate description of it. Because if you say global warming, that implies in some people's minds that, well, if the planet is heating up, then we shouldn't have the coldest winter in history in New York, for example, which happened, I don't know if that was...
Headline I ever saw, I gotta look at mail, maybe I'll put in the show notes, was it was something like Global Warming Summit canceled due to snowstorm.
Oh, yeah, right.
It was something like that, some global warming thing. It was like...
But you see, that's the thing, like, we want to take a single incident and say, see, it's not global warming. But what climate change indicates is that the climate is the long-term average of weather. And when the entire planet is heating up on a long-term average, then it's completely accurate to say that climate change is happening. It's getting warmer.
The big problem in what people were arguing about to begin with and saying that it wasn't us is because when you looked at the long term, and we're talking millions of years following the climate change, it was showing that we are in a natural upswing of our global warming due to natural reasons. It wasn't until they showed that in addition to that, we are affecting it, causing even more.
More of a spike.
Right.
Right. That's when it became, at least scientifically, a non-issue. It is occurring.
Well, here's the thing, is that, like Daryl said, and this is exact, when I wasn't sure about Daryl, what side Daryl was on this politically. But he said, all the facts are on one side. And as soon as he said that, I had no idea which side they were going to be, because you always hear the proponents of one side saying it one way or the other, saying we've got all the facts on our side and not on the other side. And Daryl, you said that, and I was like, well, you must be on one side of it.
I've been converted on this issue over the years because I do tend to believe the scientific consensus, and I don't think it's a vast conspiracy of scientists being on the payroll of...
Yeah,
government.
Seeking grants. What exactly is a green job?
It's too big to be a conspiracy.
Because what I hear,
collapse.
Because the thing is, what I'm hearing, and this is not from someone who's researched it, but from what I'm hearing, is it's back and forth. You got one side who's saying, the science is on the side saying nothing's So I personally, and this is outside of political, or maybe it's my view of things, I feel that humans affecting the Earth as a whole is difficult to do. So my view is that you can do it, but it's very difficult. So right off the bat, I'm coming in with the idea that that's not going to be the first way I look at things. So that's where I'm coming from point of view-wise. So when I hear that the science is showing this, that's great that we're affecting the Earth, okay. But then I hear the other side saying, no, you're not affecting the Earth. It's just
well, see, climate just the cows. What you have to look to is because there are scientists across many different fields. And so who you need to listen to is the climate specialist.
Yeah, that's a good point.
The weather and girls. When you look at what they say, then you get the majority that Daryl is talking about, that they're all saying, well, yes, we are affecting it.
That is a very, very good point, because the thing is, sometimes someone who's a biologist or whatever might have some commentary on string theory.
And because they're a doctor, everybody listens to it.
Right. What does a biologist study that has anything to do? 4 out of 5 doctors agree,
but they're all doctors and something.
Doctor of chiropractic.
So he's actually right. You know, the climate scientists are the ones who are trained in that field of study, and they're the ones that can make the most accurate predictive models. They're the ones to listen to. And a lot of the fringe people that are citing that this is all a myth or whatever are generally commenting outside of their field.
I'd be less likely to believe an MD than I would somebody who had a PhD in climatology.
Yeah. So, because go ahead.
I was going to say, and the politics of it is where you may talk to one of the climatologists, doctor, you know, whatever, in the field, and ask them, "Is climate change? Are we affecting climate change?" And it's the answer is yes. It goes to the whole where we've affected it. It could be very minuscule, but the thing is, yes, we did. So you take that saying, according to so-and-so expert in that, yes, we're affecting climate change, and then you go off on your own tangent like, we need to change the Earth, we got to change our jobs, we got to change this. Because the answer is technically yes.
I think one of the better summations of it that I've ever heard is on Skeptoid. Brian Dunning does that podcast, and it's generally kind of a short weekly podcast. And he did an episode on global warming, climate change. And he summed it up with something to the effect that I thought was just a brilliant way to argue it. He was saying, okay, whether or not it's all man-made or not, and whether or not the ship is filling up because of ourselves, the thing is, few people will argue the trend. The trend is climate is warming up. Question is, who caused it and what to do about it? And the thing is, he's saying, if all the countries in the world are holding a bucket and they all choose not to try to save the ship by bucketing out the water, what's the harm in taking just a reasonable step to try to save the ship, right?
Right.
So if we're just all going to stand there holding our buckets doing nothing, the ship's going to sink. You know, we might be able to save it if we do that, whether or not it's man-made. The thing is, you know, okay.
You take a proactive approach.
Let's just say, let's say hypothetically it's not even caused.
Okay, I'm going to stop this here because I think this should be an episode in the future. Okay.
I was just going to say that.
Yeah, because I didn't know we were going to get off.
Climate change would be a good episode.
Because already I've got lots of questions. I've got lots of questions about this because it seems like you've done this research. I've done no research on it. I've only got what I've heard.
In college, actually did a whole speech in a political class, and that was my thing, was to investigate that. So
well, and the whole thing is that I'm more willing to believe that if there is any, and this is without any research, this is just from what I've heard, which is, you know, I'm more willing to believe that there's not a huge amount of anything going on that's going to really affect us in the near term. Now, I would love to have you guys convince me otherwise.
Okay, well, so,
but cool. Not today.
So with all this, the global warming and the heating the Earth and stuff, is there anything that we can use to harness energy out of this?
Oh, segue.
Well, maybe. I think for the segue, what we need to look at is what I was trying to get out of this when I brought this up was the idea of how much of
before you sidetracked us?
Yeah, before I completely sidetracked us. Was how much of the stuff we're talking about is affecting the Earth in a bad way and how much of it is not. Because, you know, what you were just saying was, well, the hydrogen, that's great and everything, but then when it comes down to, well, making the hydrogen is just using the fossil fuels. And a lot of people are blind to that, and they say, well, this is clean when it's not.
Well, that's...
But it's cleaner than, say, burning gas in an engine right in your car.
And even cleaner than something really good, biofuels.
Talk to us about biofuels.
Biofuel, that's interesting.
We actually talked about, I can't remember, I think it was transportation.
Yes.
We talked about algae and gasoline.
Gasoline.
Yes.
Oh, man. Check out the grass.
That's what Cheech and Chong uses.
Where's Ralph when we need
Yeah, if you make your whole van out of gasoline, man, you could just smoke it and drive it. That would be awesome.
The Ralph Mobile.
You sounded a little too excited about that. Right there, Kale.
Yeah, from somebody who...
Is that all you're going to tell us about? That,
so, yes. Biofuel.
Yeah, biofuels.
So, is that biological? Or is it biography?
Everyone stop to take a drink.
And Daryl?
And everyone at home, take a drink.
Drink break, ready, go!
Make it a drinking
game. We still need to make a drinking game where we got to
Every time
things.
Kale says, f***.
Take a drink.
Oh, snap.
That would the problem is you'd only get like one or two drinks an episode.
That's true. Every time Kale's thinking
we can rig it. Oh, there you go.
Every time Kale says
Every time you think he's saying thinking f then you could say it.
Oh, I'm Take so in trouble you when just... I edit this.
You're creating your own problem.
I should be taking notes. Oh well.
For what?
So I can bleep out the...
The F word.
He can beep the F.
Let's leave him in.
Okay.
This is an adult podcast.
That's right.
Hashtag yeah.
Led
adult
by children.
Podcast.
So what the hell is biofuel?
Biofuel. It would be like anything like fuel made out of corn. Because they can make... Actually, any type of cellulose material can be used to ferment and use,
One of the problems with the whole concept, though, is that a lot of the things that we throw away, like corn husks and stuff like that, are not easy to convert into alcohol or energy.
Right. That's very true.
Of, the way that... So, researchers are looking at...
And they're kind of carbon equal. They're not really carbon less, you know?
Yeah, because a real issue with biofuel, especially with wheat, corn, and stuff, is making the crops. Whereas when we had in 2009 or 10, we had a spike in the cost of wheat or corn. This was in Gail's article.
How about using petroleum-based... fertilizers, though. does that keep them still?
That's another subject.
Okay. All right. Fine. Continue.
Oh, no. But you need to have land in order to grow this, and if you're using the fields that you have already as biofuel, you're taking away from the food source.
Right, and that's one of the things they talked about, definitely in some of the things I posted.
And then also you can, and growing all that food, you get sterilization, you get just...
But this is why...
That's why algae would be better to create algae, biofuel.
And also the idea of... there's research looking at microbes that that can actually break down the hard cellular material, the cellulose. So we could actually take existing waste products and turn them into energy, which is what I think is more interesting. You know, because talking about like harvesting corn, they cut the whole stalk off, right? So the stalk and the husk and a whole bunch of parts get thrown away, and all we eat are the kernels, and we throw away the cob, right?
Kernel.
So we cut down, you know, tons of plant to have just a few kernels off of it. So why not take all of that waste material that we already are growing anyway, so we don't have to take new land resources, new water resources or whatever. It's stuff that's out there already. Sometimes it gets mulched and used, but it generally is pretty hardy and doesn't get broken down. So if we find the right microbes that can actually decompose that and turn it into energy, then we're going to be in a good
situation. I think I read somewhere recently that they've actually have developed a new microbe that actually does that more efficiently.
They like the stuff you put in your sewer thing.
The Ford microbe.
And it...
Riddix. Yeah. Riddix, yeah. That's the same principle. It composts for you.
Right.
How about solar?
If we're talking about future... energy, I think that's definitely a big one.
Well, a lot of energy falls on the face of the earth. Hey, calm down, dude. It's all right. We got it. The sun
in direct sunlight, every square yard is 800 watts or something.
Well, when you come down to it...
I don't remember if that's...
And that's just what's falling on the earth. That's not even counting this huge... available power source that's just going off into space.
Well, you need to consider that almost all the energy that we use for anything, its original
Yeah, even fossil fuels originated from the sun.
Yeah. You know, fossil fuels, the sun.
They were dinosaurs. Fusion.
Mostly vegetation, but some dinosaurs here and there. But yeah, got crushed over years, turned into oil and coal.
Yeah. You're right, because pretty much the source of almost all of the energy sources that we use
is the sun. Yeah.
Right, because even the food we eat.
Yeah.
And everything.
Well, there are several different ways that we can harness solar energy. And one of the ones I like a lot is the solar tower, the one that they've actually built and it's working in Spain.
Is that in California Adventure?
I hear that.
Is that the thing with the chimney?
Right, right.
With the plastic around it that captures.
I remember you talking about this years ago.
Yeah.
Wind goes underneath and heats up. The air heats up in there, and then it goes up the
chimney. Is this with the mirrors?
And turns a turbine.
Is this with the mirrors?
No, that's a different one. This the one in the mirrors is here in California. The one that the solar tower they built
of terror.
I believe they built in Australia. They've built one, and also they definitely have built the first one. And now that it's working in Spain and creating energy, they're going to expand and build a bigger one.
So how does the solar tower
of terror
actually work?
Well, Paul explained it.
So what you have is you have a giant chimney in the middle.
It's a big tower.
Big tower. A big tower chimney. What, 4 stories high?
Actually, I think it's 100 feet high.
100 feet high. So 10,
100
so 10,
feet of terror.
So 10 stories high.
Cool.
And around this tower...
Isn't that like you're fired? Really?
If you can't be like Joey and say penis every two seconds.
Rhymes with delay of terror.
Around this tower
of terror,
there is giant square footage of thin plastic. Now, this plastic that's around it is made to repel ultraviolet, so it'll last a decade. And it allows wind to go underneath it. It's maybe, what, 4 feet, five feet off the ground?
Yeah, something like that.
Terrible wind. And the wind goes underneath and the air heats up and gets forced into the center of this giant plastic, basically a plastic circle.
Well, it's seeking to rise.
Seeking to rise to the middle, to rise up through the chimney, and in the chimney is a turbine.
The chimney?
The tower.
Of terror.
It's a chimney.
He was trying to keep him from saying it, and thanks a lot.
And it turns a turbine and makes energy. And the great thing is, even when the wind cools, the earth underneath is still warm, so it still generates more wind.
We need one of those towers right here, because it would take care of the swamp ass.
So our swamp ass could power a city.
Exactly.
So these towers would be great in, like, deserts.
Yeah. Definitely. And they work, like Paul was just alluding to, is that it actually works at night because the ground is still warmer than the outside
air. As opposed to the mirror one, which I hear they're having trouble with that one, with killing like birds or something like that.
Of terror.
Birds of terror.
The wind one. The wind, when we get to wind.
Yeah, well, the thing is the one you're talking about, Joey, is the, let me look at it, the concentrated solar thermal towers, which is the one we have here in California, where... They have mirrors that are angled to concentrate all the light on these liquid salt containers at the top of the tower.
Of terror.
And so it heats it up, all that salt. And then, of course, just like normal, it creates steam, which turns the turbine.
And doesn't like
turbine.
Turbines. Isn't like when you use the mirrors.
Turbines like, of terror?
That was kind of unintentional. It makes sense. It actually makes sense.
I'm sorry to all of our Muslim friends out there that actually try to listen.
I kill you!
Yes.
Oh, what's next?
Can you even remember what you were going to say?
Oh, it's going to be something about the mirrors and the mass device and reflecting
it.
What?
Or
whatever. The mass device. It was used by Cobra in order to destroy the planet.
Oh, I see. Okay.
All right. So solar, good.
Well,
solar good.
Yeah, solar good.
No, but the thing
and
about...
And the solar cells are
And solar good. Panels are...
excuse you.
They're here.
Well,
they're getting more common. I mean, very easier. I remember. I think Daryl was the first family I knew that even had solar panels, and this was like
yeah, solar panels.
That was like all high tech.
Yeah, they actually weren't the what's the word there? Electro photoelectric.
They were passive. Passive
they were,
solar.
They were for heating the water directly.
Passive solar.
Passive, okay. Right.
I don't really want to get okay.
Anyway,
what?
So the thing is passive. That I don't know if you guys noticed the thing I posted, but they just recently had a solar panels that they've created that are now reaching 44%.
Oh, that's really good.
That's what I'm saying.
Holy cow.
Holy!
44. I mean,
you say 44?
Efficiency.
You said 44?
I said 44.7.
Yeah!
Well, if you go to Fry's and pick up a panel just off the shelf, you're looking at usually like 12%.
Did you say 12? 12!
Wait, before we go for what do you mean by percentage? What are you
That's efficiency.
That's 44.7. How efficiently it turns the sunlight into power.
44!
44 okay. is spectacular.
And that's why I'm saying this.
You normally don't get that unless you're in outer space.
I would say it's fantastic.
They were just able to to make that happen, and I was excited about
I guess, is it one of those things where they made a few in a laboratory, but they're not...
Well, this is their first... Right, this is their first... They aren't producing them.
Right.
This is just proof of concept.
And that comment
Why am I doing
about,
hashtags
That comment
in the
I
area.
Made about doing that in space is that there have been some made for satellites.
Solar in space!
In 3D. And, yeah, they were special made. They're not mass-produced, though, at
right.
this point. So.
Right. But
and the efficiency doesn't matter whether you're in or out of the atmosphere. I didn't want to imply that.
I think that solar, the thing about solar is that it's the best direct way to get energy, and in the future, once we find the best ways to optimize it, that's pretty much
Straight
where everything's going to come
source,
from.
Just
it,
like
pretty
the
much, yeah.
Heat from our swamp ass.
Yeah, exactly. So that's probably where everything's going to be, but until
Actually,
we get to that
point.
Actually,
the heat from our swamp ass is pretty indirect, because we had to eat.
But until we get to that point.
True.
Right.
Yeah. And it still came from the
sun. And that
sun.
Thing,
but
and
until
we
get
ate,
to
probably ate some sort of.
I'm just going to get closer to the speaker. But until we get to that point
of terror,
we'll probably have to keep getting
swamp ass,
swamp gas,
yes, or geothermic gas.
This turned
well,
into
thing
energy
is,
from the earth, wind,
right.
waves,
geothermal,
swamp ass, all that stuff.
This is Mad Libs edition of our podcast. Like, Joey's just starts saying something and we throw in a word.
Well, so the next thing we're going to talk about
tits.
Is... Hallelujah!
How much can one breast absorb from the sun?
Oh, I thought he was talking about the birds.
Oh, I was thinking more of the turbine action.
The twirlies. Oh, man. That...
Oh, no. This one way off the rails.
Oh, 47, man.
No, I agree with you. The geothermal is really an excellent way to get energy because you're getting it from the heat from inside the earth.
Which is another minor source. That geothermal is not solar based.
But it came. Oh, you're right. I was going to say it originally came from the sun. Well, you could say it originally came from the sun because
gravity
of the sun.
So what would a geothermal...
No, the gravity of the earth is actually creating pressure, which is generating heat. So
it's from the formation
it's
of the
from
planet.
The planet.
Yeah.
So how would the device collect the energy?
Okay. Well, what you do is you drill down to where it is hotter.
So like a deep tunnel.
Exactly.
Of terror.
And so you put...
I like to drill down.
You can put water, pump water down there, and then it gets heated up.
I'm not
you bring
do this
the heat,
forever.
Heated water up. And it turns into steam, which of course turns turbine.
It's amazing how these are Excellent. So OTEC like, and we knew about this stuff before.
Yeah.
Well, all you need is a thermal differential, and then you can display it.
And actually, I think it's Google that is actually
like
using a geothermal power to generate one of its server farms in Seattle.
I just want you to picture Daryl biting his lower lip after he said drill deep and exploit it and nodding at me with wide eyes like,
yeah, you're going to feel his journey.
Yeah.
Who came last?
Oh,
it looks like you again.
It's definitely going to be me.
Anyone want to see my solar tower?
Anyway,
one
of the advantages of geothermal power as opposed to others is that if we actually... have a nuclear winter, or if a super volcano explodes and covers the earth in ash for years, geothermal power will still work.
Okay, true.
And the others won't. fission and fusion.
We could also have extra atmosphere.
Solar. Yeah. Yeah, that's true, too.
But then, you would have thought that the robots in the Matrix would have figured that out before using humans as batteries.
Yeah.
Why don't we just use the sun?
Okay,
well, no, because the humans cover
that's
the,
right.
That's right.
That's
right. So, like, let's just drill into the freaking ground.
It's Transformers also, because, like, you know.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, they're all like, let's form Energon cubes and collect the energy from the Hoover Dam. Like, oh, yeah, good job, Decepticons. Yeah. Let's go on an oil platform in the ocean and collect Energon cubes.
Even the movie, even the second movie, we were just watching it. It's like, we need to blow up the sun to get the energy from it. Just get the energy from it.
It's blowing up on its own.
It's already blowing up.
Exactly.
Well, that's what. Oh, my God.
We must introduce solar panels to the Decepticons.
Exactly.
Look at me. I'm collecting energy. Ah, I feel so good.
Ow, I just hurt my pinky.
Oh.
Joey's been hiding his head a lot this episode. I think it's because Joey's now officially an adult. Because, you know, he's got a kid. And he's got all these serious things to think about, and us chuckleheads are over here laughing at everything.
Dickheads. I mean, yeah, whatever, chuckle.
And Paul's been a parent long enough that he's already insane, so.
But Joey's over here just going like, yeah. Oh my God, these guys are morons.
Joey would never say that.
Yes, he would.
You want me to rub it?
Oh.
Did you bang it?
I don't know.
You know, that sounds really bad, Paul.
You want to rub and bang in the same question, the same sentence.
Yeah.
Who's going to come first?
Wind!
Now, wind power, with the wind power turbines, I was reading or watching watching a special on YouTube. And
you
it was a special one.
It wouldn't be a screen reader, it'd be like a screen video producer. So you get an article, you load it up, and it makes a video of it
instant. That
I like
the wind farms up in like Seattle north the northwest area was actually killing a bunch of bats.
So it was taken out
a huge amount of these bats that were migrating because the
blades
going around. There was two theories. One day. They generate heat.
Okay, now we need to get the
bugs,
picture of the horny bat.
And they would go to eat it,
that
and
was
then you see them in the thermal.
It's
getting whacked by these. Yeah. These
this is really a strange juxtaposition here because Paul and I
really?
Are actually being serious about the
death.
And Daryl, and you're off the rails already.
Oh, God.
Usually it's the other way around.
Have you ever seen the pictures of the bats with erections?
No.
Daryl?
No, I am not seeing bats with erections.
Case and point.
I am looking that up right now.
We'll
put some of those in the show notes. Erect bats.
Playback.
Seriously, though?
The Playback channel.
Batman. Bats.
Okay.
On blue pills.
No, they don't need no blue pills, man.
Speaking of, let's talk about tidal energy.
Dick, dude. Serious.
50% dick.
That's what the Joker says.
The Joker says I'm 50% dick?
The bat.
What? Oh, the bat.
The bat is 50%.
You're 50% dick.
Made with 10% real fruit juice.
All right.
What about wave energy?
Getting back on track.
Let's wave goodbye to this podcast.
So wind energy. Drive through Palm Springs. See the fans.
Okay, good. Now wave energy.
Oh, damn.
Let me see. I'm going to see the erect bat.
Oh, no.
The best reaction ever.
Holy shit.
He's gonna suck it himself.
He can. That's pretty good. That means every bat can suck himself off. Now that is great.
I won't be. I can't get that out of my head now.
Wow. So I didn't want to listen to some Steely Dan.
What?
Why? What does that have to do with bat dicks?
What is the hell?
What if bat dicks?
I don't know what that is.
What do bat dicks have to do with our topic?
Well, we already know they don't.
Because they're energetic. No, we're talking about dead bats. Oh, jeez.
Holy crap. Hola.
Oh.
Damn. No wonder there's so few bats, because the male bats can just satisfy themselves.
Oh, man. Do they do it while flying?
That's when they run into things.
Would you? Wouldn't you try?
So you can make wave energy.
Yes.
From the ocean and using Otex.
Well, the wave energy.
Thank you guys for joining us for our podcast today.
What does Otex do?
The wave energy.
Ocean thermal energy converter.
Bam.
Well, isn't conversion?
Yeah, but isn't wave the basic wave energy is having like the buoy with. With a shaft and it's going up.
I wish you could see this, people, because Paul is just motion. Like his huge penis.
He's acting like he's a bat.
It's like Paul took his wings and was stroking
his. You know, the buoy in the water.
It creates a piston, yes.
A piston.
Yes.
Right. We understand.
That's exactly what wave energy does. Creates a piston moving up and down, which turns a turbine. Yes. They're because Sea Solar Power is a company that actually makes OTEX.
Okay.
And they're experimental. They're not like functioning to create power for like cities and stuff. However, the one I posted here, Lockheed Martin, is a company that is now going
I've
to
heard of them.
They're going to revisit the idea of OTEX and actually try to make it happen.
Yeah.
And there's open system OTEX where you use the actual water that you bring up, or you can also use what was it? Not chlorine. Anyway, it was another substance that that boils at a lower temperature.
Okay, right.
And that's a closed system OTEX.
Right. So you're just exposing it to the transference of the lower temperature water down deep.
Exactly.
That's one of those things, too, where this is another one of those systems where you're not dealing with an extreme differential in temperatures.
No, just 10% or more.
But you have
really to
move things a long distance. So you're always running the risk of putting more energy into the system than you produce.
Well, the one good thing about that is that that they found when they actually did some test ones, like the one in Hawaii, the Nail Ha or whatever it was, is that all you have to do is have a pump at the surface pulling the water up, because it will get drawn in from the bottom.
Right.
So eventually that pump is going to pump out the deep ocean water.
Right.
So it actually is pretty efficient.
But then where do you dispose the cold water that's pumped to the surface?
That's a good point. The thing is that it's very rich in nitrogen. So actually you could use it to I'm not say fertilize the ocean, but you pump it into a bay where you have
quite a man
where you have
to
fish.
Fertilize the ocean, I tell you.
And you put plants in there, and it will actually use the nitrogen in there, and it will create a bloom of green. So there's a lot of benefits, not just of power, but of bringing that ocean water up.
We also run the potential of maybe decreasing the surface water a little bit because you're mixing it with the waste deep water.
Well, I don't think it would be, you could call it waste. I mean, it's just cold. It's just
but
cold
it may
water.
Change the climate. Yeah.
Well, if you had a whole lot of them, like a million of them, maybe. But if you're even 10,000 or even 100,000, you probably couldn't even make a dent.
I mean, thermodynamically, it's the same energies on the planet's surface, so I don't think that's really...
Yeah.
Or maybe the ecosystem.
But that's right, though, because you could wind up with, you know, an overabundance of certain kinds of algae or whatever in that area around the
kill the sea turtles.
Right.
Well, that's why...
Mess up the
ecology. That's why I think that if you were going to actually do this, you would want to use that that water so it's not escaping immediately out into the ocean. You're using the potential of it and the nutritive value of it to create fish or lobsters or whatever. And then after it's been used, then you can put it into the ocean and it probably won't cause any problem.
I'm not down on OTEX. Don't get me wrong. I'm just saying.
I didn't think you were, but you're bringing up good
issues.
Good points.
You're not down on OTC?
No. You don't know me. Wait, OCP? What?
OTEC.
Anyway, we actually mentioned all of the energy, future energy ideas. Can you believe it?
Oh, that was it?
That was it.
Oh, my gosh. The list was so short.
OTEC was the last. It was so short. My God, it was huge.
Thank
like
you.
It
reminds me of a bat.
Like a bat dick.
You know?
I haven't gotten past the bat dick.
He can't. He's stumped.
I have the bat dick. The whole thing is just... I'm still there.
Oh. Yeah.
So what were we talking about, OTEX?
We were, but we're
now they're mammals. So hence why it looks, you know, like something familiar.
Okay. Hold on. Let me... Okay, bat dicks.
Okay, now
get the bat dicks off my head!
Now that you've gotten it out of your mouth.
Well, there is one thing that I didn't...
No, you know what's really more bizarre are the bat balls.
It's true.
The neighbors think we're doing some pretty crazy porn. All right, so I think we're done with...
I've got
with
a ball bat.
...energy and bat dicks for this week. Paul, you are our... chooser for next week.
Yes.
What's our topic?
I would like us to discuss... artificial intelligence.
Nice.
Evolution, the uses, and whatever
you want to
talk about.
Do we have to watch a certain Steven Spielberg movie as homework?
No, we don't.
I've never seen it.
Say it. Neither have I. What was it again?
Artificial intelligence.
Oh.
AI.
It's not like it's the best movie ever, but it's interesting.
Maybe that could be our movie to watch. Because it brings up a lot of interesting points about
AI. I'd love to, but I probably will not watch it.
No? Watch the
trailer. We can watch that trailer. Centennial Man with Robin
Williams. Oh, that's actually better. Yeah, that's really good. That brings up a lot of points.
It's an interesting thing, but I think that the ideas that they bring up in AI are more disturbing.
You can also watch Highlander.
Topical.
What?
Highlander?
Because it has to do with someone living, outliving everyone else around.
War Games?
Just like a robot with AI would.
Oh, now I understand that.
Right. Okay, so next week, artificial intelligence, more tech talk, let's bat dick. I'm Joey Shammel, and... More tech talk, less bat dick.
Everybody's having to interpret less for filling. Me tonight, you know? I'm not getting it on the first try.
I'm Joey Shamblin, and you can find me at imrambling.com.
Want to tell him my name? I'm Paul Hottinger. You can reach me at heyispaul.com.
I'm Kale Anderson. You can reach me at romsrants.com. At blogspot.com.
I'm Daryl. You can reach me at jors.com, G-I-R-S.
Thank you. Have a good week, and yay for energy. Woo!
Thanks for listening. You can now stop screaming at the open air. Listeners should put their minds back in their upright positions and resume traditional thinking. Find us on imrambling.com for access to all of our weekly ramblings, show notes, general discussions, and any projects from incoherent ramblings. Like us on Facebook and rate us on iTunes. So long, and thanks for all the fish.
No,
bad dick! Somebody had stopped.